Good afternoon and welcome to Seeding the Muse. My name is Chris Cavalieri. I'm a professor in the College of Communications Department of Film and Television. I serve on the BU Arts Council, which is a team of faculty appointed by the provost to support and advise the staff of the BU Arts Initiative. In the spirit of the council's awareness of inclusion, I would like to offer a visual self-description to anyone in need. I'm a white male, just north of 60, with brown hair, brown eyes, 6'2". I wear glasses as a necessity, not as a fashion accessory. And all on this sunny, trying to be spring-like day, I'm happy that my dress shirt is sufficient as I'm attending today's event from my office in the College of Communication. And I should add, he, his, him are my associative pronouns. We're grateful that you've joined us today. The BU Arts Initiative is a unique program whose mission is to develop and execute arts programs that engage BU students by building community, supporting interdisciplinary arts teaching, learning, research, and highlighting narratives of inclusion. Today, you'll hear from four faculty from across the university who've created a variety of successful programs and projects supported by the BU Arts Initiative. We hope that what you hear sparks some ideas, because after the speakers, we'll break into discussion groups for about 30 minutes to explore your ideas and the potential to develop them into meaningful outcomes. Then we'll report back as an entire group, and at the end of the session, Ty Furman, Managing Director of the Arts Initiative, will explain just how the Arts Initiative can support you. So without further ado, it gives me great pleasure to introduce my colleague, Jen Beard from BU School of Public Health.
Hi, everybody. It's really a delight to be here today. I am in the Department of Global Health. I'm a clinical associate professor and a visual description. I'm a white woman over, I'm 55. This picture shows brown hair. I now have pink and purple hair, which I think is much more flattering. And I wear glasses. They're teal cat eye glasses, and I'm wearing a gray turtleneck, and I'm in my office here at the corner of Albany Street and Massachusetts Avenue on the medical campus. So to jump into the story, in October of 2019, the School of Public Health worked with the Arts Initiative to bring Rodessa Jones, a theater artist, to the School of Public Health for a week. And while she was here, she, on different days of this week, basically the idea was to build up to a symposium that was a day-long symposium on Friday that it was focused on 1619 and 400 years of inequality. So we were trying to build momentum toward that. So Rodessa came on Tuesday, because we actually did this the week of Columbus Day week. And we started off with a workshop for faculty, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that in a minute. Then at another point, Rodessa went and taught in my colleague Carol Dolan's class. Carol is the director of our mental health and substance abuse certificate program, and she teaches a class on trauma. And Rodessa went and taught in that class. And I should mention, I can't remember if I said it already, Rodessa created the Medea Project, among many, many other things. But the Medea Project is focused on incarcerated women and training and working with incarcerated women to tell and enact their stories as a form of healing. So the other thing that she did a public performance of the Medea Project, or of excerpts of the Medea Project. And I think the thing that she did that was my most favorite thing was we had a workshop specifically for students, for our students here in the School of Public Health who are master's degree students. And we also had some high school students who were participating in a program here. And she basically did an improv theater exercise workshop. And so she had students in a conference room here in the Crosstown building on the medical campus doing all sorts of things that I don't think anybody has ever done on this campus before, you know, in a group of 30, you know, sort of just it was beautiful. And the fact that we also had kids from the local neighborhood who were here interacting with our MPH students was wonderful too. I'll just quickly say that this came out of me meeting Ty because of Boston University joining the A2RU consortium, which is the Association for Arts at Research Universities. I met Ty in Colorado, not in Boston. But once I met him, I immediately thought, I need to know this guy because we need more arts over here on the medical campus. Often it feels like we're in our own little world. And that we're disconnected from all these wonderful things that are going on across town. And that we're, one of the things I'd been hearing from my students for a long time was that they felt like they were sort of cut off in all of their quantitative classes because they're taking epi and biostats and they're really thinking about evidence and research. They were feeling cut off from their creative side. So what we wanted to do was find outlets for sort of building that, nurturing it, because it's also an important part of public health and public health practice. And so Ty came to me and said one day, let's try and bring an artist to the School of Public Health. I said, great idea. I have no idea how we should do that. So it was all about collaboration. We got Emily Barbo from the Activist Lab here at the School of Public Health to join us. And she came up with the idea of having Rodessa participate in the 1619 project. And it just kind of all unfolded from there. And so I guess my message here is that the sort of casual connections that I was able to make kind of over a period of years that, like, again, started in Colorado of all places, really led to this wonderful experience. And the last thing I'll say is that the culmination of Rodessa's time here was she was the closing speaker of the 1619 symposium, which was a day-long super intense discussion. And she had people up and moving and processing. And it was, once again, just sort of something that we don't usually do or see in how we sort of do anything here at the School of Public Health. And I think that's the lasting impact, is just that we now have this idea that this is important and that the arts are a part of who we are and that these are relationships we should build. So I will end there. And I would love to introduce Ziba Cranmer, who is from BU Spark.
Thank you, Jennifer. What I love about BU is you come to these events and you meet people like Jennifer that you didn't know about, as you just said, these sort of serendipitous meetings that get you excited. So I'm Ziba Cranmer. I use she, her, hers pronouns, and I'm from BU Spark. I'll do a visual description. I'm in my home office, and so I'm surrounded by windows and light, which is great until it's lit and then it's not so great, but we're okay right now. I have brown, curly, shoulder-length hair. I'm a white woman in my 40s, late 40s. I'm wearing brown and gray stripes. And the most interesting thing in my background is I have a stack of books. Oh, one of those cool bookshelves that has a slot every couple of books. So it seems like your books are floating in midair. So that's neat. And I'm at BU Spark. And Spark is we describe ourselves as a technology incubator and experiential learning lab for computer science and engineering projects and interdisciplinary computer science and engineering projects. And at the time of our collaboration with the Arts Initiative, I was based at the Hariri Institute for Computing, which is a research center institute that is really meant to bridge between disciplines, the computing and data science disciplines, and the rest of the university at BU. I'm now part of the new Faculty for Computing and Data Sciences, which is an academic unit that is that has the same goal, but as opposed to research, it's really about the academic degrees and partnering with other schools and colleges across the university to make sure that they have access to to high quality computing data science programming and degree options and the opportunity to apply them to these different disciplines. So that's where I sit now. We mostly work with students, and when I was at the Hariri Institute, even though we were in the research entity, we were being incubated there, we were connected to the Arts Initiative to bring a computational artist in residence. And I think similar to what Jennifer described, where you're thinking about these areas of the university where maybe people aren't normally thinking about art, especially conceptual art. And we wanted to bring that inspiration to the computer science and engineering community at BU. So we partnered to co-fund Francisco Alarcón, who is a computational artist in residence. It was I don't know if it's a term, but that was the term we use. And he really works at the intersection of visual arts and technology. So he was undergrad. He was an engineering major, and then he went on to study art and is in the Graduate School of Design, getting his PhD in film and visual studies. And so he's very eclectic and diversity of disciplines that he works in. And the residency brought him to BU for 4 months to do a couple of things. One, to work on projects that he, you know, was pursuing, and to give him resources and support to do that, and to share the output of his time at BU with the broader community. And then the other part of the collaboration was to engage students in workshops and opportunities to play themselves at that intersection of art and computation. So we had a series of different workshops. We had one on, it was really an introduction to computational art, and students from all different backgrounds sort of encouraged to think outside the box and to bring their skills and create. It was very divergent, and it was a lot of fun. And he also did a bunch of exhibitions and pop-ups around campus. One of my favorites, and I wish it was still there because it would be really calming, was at Silsi. And it was a narrative of a wave, I think it was called. This was in the fall of 2019, I should have said. And it was basically a projection of a computer-generated image of a wave simulation. And it was projected against the large white wall at Silsi, and you could see it from the street, and it was so calming and beautiful. And that's where I go get my COVID tests regularly. And so it would be really nice if it was still there. And it was just, it was really beautiful. It was just sort of flowing square of wave. So he also worked with students, and they came up with some pretty interesting little robots, dancing robots that responded to noise and other inputs. And he just had a great sort of energetic personality, was always hanging out in the Spark space and around campus, engaging students. And I think it was a really successful collaboration. I think it also pushed, you know, what I really loved about it is that it was not practical at all, which was really important, because I think, you know, in this sort of era of functionality and productivity and making things that are useful, especially in the technical realm, it was really, I think, a great opportunity for especially students to get out of that domain and apply their skills in a fun and exploratory and creative realm. So that's me. And then I am going to send it over to Anne.
Thank you, Ziba. Hello, everybody. Let's see, can you hear me okay? Yes. All right. My name's Anne Escher. Pronouns she, her, hers. And I am a white 40-something woman with light brown shoulder-length hair pulled back. I'm wearing a bright blue shirt. I'm in my home office. And today I'm here to tell you my story of how I connected with the BU Arts Initiative and the faculty initiatives when I first started on full-time faculty here at BU. I'm an occupational therapist, And I became a full-time faculty member in 2014, having been an adjunct faculty member before that. And I think it was that year, it's been a while now, I attended a workshop that was hosted by the BU Arts Initiative on visual thinking strategies that a group from the dental school was putting on. So some faculty members there were talking about their experiences using visual thinking strategies for their dental students. Visual thinking strategies is this way of looking at work, art, and you look really deeply to understand, and you do it in a group, to understand others' perspectives and back up your observations with visual evidence. And there are three core questions. They are, what's happening here in this picture or in this space? What do you see that makes you say that? And what more can we find? And the workshop was great because they talked about how, you know, they do this work in the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum, and then they bring it back to their courses and they look at mouths and teeth with those same questions. And so it's sort of used as a diagnostic school, a tool for the dental school. And so a colleague and I were there and we thought, wow, this has so many applications for occupational therapy. And so we brought it back to the department. And we now, for years now, do as part of our orientation for our clinical doctorate students in OT, they do a day or a few couple of hours, I guess, this visual thinking strategies experience at the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum. And they start with those, again, like amazing art, world-renowned art, and then hopefully bring those questions back to when they're thinking about their clients. We do it every year and at orientation, like I said, and then we do sort of a booster session in the spring semester. So we start in the fall. And it's to sort of try to encourage these habits of mind around understanding other people's perspectives, that when you look at something, other people look and see a different story, backing up their observations with visual evidence. And it's been really great. The students have really enjoyed it as an experience, but then also I think appreciate this connection between the art and their life as a clinician. And additionally, I just wanted to mention that in the OT department, we have sort of increasingly been integrating arts into some of our assignments and our curriculum. So we have, for instance, one of the courses that I teach is about occupations across the lifespan. And we do a digital storytelling project as a culminating assignment. And students talk about, to tell a story of how an area of occupation might change in meaning and content over the life course. And so they use video, they use visuals, they use storytelling as a part of that. And then another faculty member, and I think that's the picture that's here, has students prepare fun skits for Boston Public Schools to share about backpack awareness and being safe in backpack wearing for elementary school students. So it started in 2015 from being, going to this workshop. And now this is my first year on the BU Arts Council. And it's pretty neat how many applications there are for this integration of art and curriculum. And so that's all I have to say today. And so I'd like to introduce Clay Hopper from the BU School of Theater.
Thank you, Anne. Thanks very much. Hello, everybody. My name is Clay Hopper. As Anne said, I'm from the BU School of Theater. I'm a senior lecturer in directing in theater arts there. As a visual, I'd like to describe that I am a white guy in my mid-40s. I'm unshaven. I'm in a very strangely painted room with a Banksy print over my shoulder of a girl holding an umbrella with rain falling from inside the umbrella over her, which now that I think about it seems oddly appropriate given the times we're in. I I want to tell you a little bit about the project that got me interested or revealed to me the BU Arts Initiative. But it revealed to me a lot more than that. And let me start at the beginning. Back in spring of 2019, I was in an executive committee with the dean, with a few other faculty members from the College of Fine Arts, one of whom is Professor James Grady, a graphics design professor, who also works with Ziba at Spark. And we were talking about interdisciplinary work and how we wanted to do more of it. And I brought up that I was really interested in examining the way that projected media and images relate to live performers in a theatrical context. And he said, hey, I'm into that as well. So we started talking and we decided that, you know, we really wanted to try to work together on something. So the next thing that I proposed to do was an experiment in a third floor studio space, an adaptation of George Orwell's 1984, where we dispensed with three-dimensional scenery entirely and created a completely projected media environment for the actor. The idea was that what I wanted to see was, could live performers in a theatrical context do a play and have it not be subsumed by the projected media experience? Could projected media images be integrated into the psychology of the play in such a way that it brought you into it rather than shut you out of it? Little did I know at that point that this is a research question. So we did this, and in the process of putting on the production, James connected me with a software engineer from the College of Engineering named Ellen Lowe, who was a senior, and she was into creative coding. And she and I and the design team for the production, we worked together on what's called generative graphics and computational vision. Essentially, in order to make the environment that we were creating for the actor more immersive, we wanted to create imagery, projected imagery, that could be physically interacted with by the actor. So whenever an actor made a movement, it would then be responded to by the generated graphic environment. And they were generative graphics in the sense that they were sort of organic. They would change slightly every time it happened. So this was an eye-opening experience for me because we were using algorithms and computer science, essentially, to create a more immersive narrative experience. And it worked beautifully. And when a colleague of mine came to see it, she said, you know what you should do is you should go talk to Ty Furman at the BU Arts Initiative. And I said, what's that? I have been working here since 2012. And I don't know, maybe it was some sort of degree of osmosis, but I kind of got this sense as a theater artist in a big research university like Boston University that I had to somehow, I don't know, justify my existence inside that container, or you know, I just felt in some way siloed from the rest of the university in some fundamental way. Well, when I met with Ty and after working with James and Ellen, I realized that, you know, what I was doing was very much in line with what's known as practice-led research or practice-based research. This was an eye-opening event for me, to say the least. And what happened as a result is that the research infrastructure that is at BU suddenly opened itself up to me. And I began to see what I was doing in my artistic practice as something that was directly applicable inside of a research environment. And I started, I went to A2RU, the Alliance for Research, Alliance for the Arts and Research Universities. I gave a talk on this production. I met multiple other artists there that were engaged in research, extremely varied. And I came back with a renewed commitment to not only engaging more with my work as an artist in terms of research, but also helping other people see what they're doing in their own discipline as something that could be equally applicable in an artistic realm. So when I met with Ty and he pointed me to all of these different organizations, one of the people he connected me to was Ziba at Spark. And after one of the program at Spark there is they assign software developers to work on projects for outside clients. And I was a client, and what we started to work on was a novel software application that would allow generative graphics to be designed by theatrical designers that don't have any coding experience. And we've been working on that now for like 3 semesters, and it's really come a long way. And we're really close to having something that's going to be deployed in the spring of 2022, when we are all getting back together again and watching plays. And it's just been a very exciting time for me as a theater artist to be inside of a research institution like BU. And the work that Ty is doing and the initiative is something that I believe very much in. So I asked Ty if I could be a part of it, and here I am. What's most important to me in terms of the work that the initiative does is that I reach people and sort of reach out to people and get them to see things a little bit differently about what they do, and to foster connections between disparate areas of inquiry. I think that's really important. I think that the arts has a certain power in that regard, but I think that what goes into making art is very much similar to what goes into every other research field of inquiry. So I'm very happy to be a part of this, and I'm happy to be talking to you about it today.